Happy to welcome everybody today to session 2114, Securing Soft Targets. I'll be your moderator today. My name is Joe Doe. I'm the council chairman for the Hospitality, Entertainment, and Tourism Security Council, today's session sponsor. With great pleasure to introduce James C. Reynolds, CPP. He's going to discuss securing soft targets today. Definitely a hot topic in the current trend of security worldwide. Brief introduction of James. He's the Director of Safety and Security for the Chicago Cubs. He's been in that role for the last 2 years. Pivotal role overseeing the massive renovation and expansion of Wrigley Field in the adjacent area. Prior to that, he was a Safety and Security Director for Hilton Worldwide for 13 years in the D.C. and Chicagoland area. And even before that, a brief amount of time with mall security and open events. So definitely expertise in all areas of what we would consider soft targets. So with that said, James Reynolds, the floor is yours.
Morning, everyone. Everybody hear me okay? My style is a little different. First of all, thank you for coming. I'm not a typical speaker that's going to get up here and preach or try to tell you that I know everything. I'm going to share my experiences. I'm typically an more open, fluid speaker. I'm going to talk to you like we're having lunch together. That's just my style. I'm also not originally from Chicago, so I may drop a y'all or something like that. I'm from Virginia, so I do have a little country twang every now and then. So with that said, we'll just go ahead and get started. And I originally did this presentation a few years back. And one of the reasons I felt it was important to do it is I didn't feel like there was enough information out there about soft targets. We heard the terms when I originally did this. You would hear the terms all the time in the news. And they just lumped us all in one big bucket about the soft targets. There's soft targets out there. So I started doing some research and trying to come up with information on the topic, and I, again, noticed that there wasn't a lot out there on it. So I did the presentation, and now, a few years removed of doing it, I was asked to do this again, and in the process, and the reason I chose this slide to start off with is most of our buildings and properties and the things that you may be in charge of, when they originally were built, soft targets wasn't a phenomenon in the world, so they might not have been designed well. 101 years ago, when this ballpark was built, the soft target wasn't an issue. They didn't have to take those things in consideration. And as I go through here, through this presentation, I'll try to talk a little bit about the challenges I'm facing right now in a multi-year renovation of a 100-year-old ballpark and what the requirements Major League Baseball is asking of me and the urban environment that this ballpark lives in, what I can and I cannot do, and the challenges I'm facing. And hopefully that can help resonate with you and some of the challenges you might face. And together at the end with questions, maybe we can help each other figure some of these things out. So getting started, when I first did this, one of the things I came across was the definition that is out there. And the definition for soft target, that the textbook version, is that it's a person or thing that's relatively unprotected from military or terrorist attack. And I just didn't think it was very fitting for what the reality of it is. The reality of it, I think a more practical definition, is a gathering of people and or structure which has open access. It's open to the public. With little or no restriction and relatively unprotected. This is a little bit more practical for me because, you know, when you're dealing with just saying it's a person or a thing that's relatively unprotected, but is it, you know, we deal with hotels, we deal with malls, we deal with sports venues. You're inviting the public into your place, then a lot of times you want it to remain inviting. You know, the Wrigley Field, its nickname is the Friendly Confines. So we got to be friendly. We can't sit there and pat you down and go through three levels of security and lose that friendly confine look. So how do you balance those things? Because you have to be open to public access. So again, I think it's unfair to lump everything in as a soft target. A soft target is just a broad term to me. So I tried to put it in categories or put it in buckets. And those buckets I like to put them in is open access, and I'm going to explain all these. What I feel is an open access, soft access, a ticketed access, or a hybrid. I feel like most of everything that you would call a soft target today is in one of these buckets. So the first one that I talk about is the open access. I think this is the true soft target. Like, this is the bottom level of security and soft targets for me, is because when you're dealing with open markets, state fairs, festivals, shopping malls, and places of worship, which is the places of worship is something I just recently added to this, given the things that we've had with the shootings in churches and things of that nature. I mean, these things are designed to be open. If you take a farmer's market, for example, you could have hundreds and hundreds of people here, and it's in just inviting a lone shooter or something bad to happen, and it's a gathering of people. And even though malls have visible security, I worked in a mall for several years as a director of security. Malls, they have security, but they're designed to be open. They're designed to have people just walk in and shop. So a lot of times the security there, they can be visible. They can create deterrence by their visibility, but they're really reactive to what's going on. So I treat all these in one bucket as an open access. Soft access, I'm talking about the hotels, theaters, mass transit. Even though these things, hotels, they have security, but they have so many different ways to get in, and they have to remain open and welcoming. They're in the hospitality industry. They still have some restrictions at night, and they do some, this is why I don't put this in the same bucket as the mall security, because you still do some restrictive things at night. You may lock some of the doors in the perimeter. And then in theaters and mass transit, yes, you have ticketing process. I don't put them in the ticketing bucket, because although they're ticketed, you still are just, I got a ticket, I can get in. There's no real screening process to get on the train or to get in the theater. You buy a ticket, you get in. It's a little different. So that brings me to the ticketing piece. You know, theme parks, sports venues, museums, and concert sites, they're a little different than the other one, even though there's tickets involved, because here you're buying a ticket in a sports venue, and you're going through a screening process. You're having your bag checked. You're going through a magnetometer. The same thing with a lot of museums nowadays. So it's a little different than the soft access. Hybrids, if you take the Sears Tower, I still call it the Sears Tower. If you take the Sears Tower, is a prime example. The open floors, you can get in there, you can go to the different shoppings or the restaurants. It's open to the public access. But if you're trying to get to the higher levels, you have to go through some kind of security screening process, have your bags gone through the x-ray machine. You have to have some kind of credential to get to the other side. So that's why I put these more into the hybrid access. And again, these are all uniquely different than just calling them all soft targets. So the security challenges. So the security challenges a lot of these faces, the biggest one is we're in America. We expect things to be opened and inviting to the public. You know, we want people to come into museums, into the malls, or into farmers markets. I don't think as a country we're ready to get to where some of the other countries are and really lock things down and pat people down before they go into a church. I hope we never get there, but the reality of it is this is a challenge for security professionals. Is we got to maintain hospitality, we got to maintain being the friendly confines, but we also want you to protect us and make sure nothing bad happens. It's a challenge we're all going to have to face. Security, same thing, security must not unduly impede normal operations or commerce. Security is difficult for a lot of venues because it's hard to control screening, control access, or you're not doing any kind of security screening from the people coming into your building. You may have a lot of access points, a lot of entries, a lot of hotels. I give you a prime example is the Hawaiian Village. It's five towers. It's a huge complex, a lot of ways to get in and out. You can come in from the beach. You can come in from the street. And in the meanwhile, you're a soft target, and you got to protect the 5,000 keys that you have in that building. So, you know, these are examples of things that you have to take in consideration or a challenge you may face. Large volumes of people, you know, challenge we have with Wrigley and trying to control and protect it is we got a lot. If you've ever been there, there's a lot of bars on Clark Street. We have four main entries to the build to the ballpark, but over 70% of our entry up to 15 minutes before first pitch come through Gate K right under the marquee. It's just naturally where people are funneling to because the marquee's there, the iconic marquee, all the bars are right there, and we just get a flood out of 41,000 people. We easily have to process 20,000 people with 15 to 20 minutes before first pitch. When you're dealing with those volumes of people, how do you make sure your security controls stay, you know, diligent and everyone's doing what they're supposed to be doing? Urban venues a lot of times don't have the setback you would like. I mentioned this earlier. Is Major League Baseball asks that all venues have a 100-foot outer perimeter, a 100-foot standoff from the ballpark. Again, if you Wrigley, challenge that I have is there's one point that I have 6 feet from the corner of the building to Addison, which does not get shut down at any time during the game. I have active traffic flowing 6 feet from my ballpark, but so I have no set-off point. I have no way to set back the vehicles or make sure I have that perimeter and I can worry about the threats that might come from that. Positive identification. What I think makes you, this is one that I think makes soft targets very unique, is when you work in a, if I'm director of security for a corporate building, I know who my employees are. I know my employees know what they're supposed to do. They have some kind of identification and you get used to the faces. If someone doesn't belong, it's easy to point out. If you're dealing with a hotel, you're dealing with a shopping mall, you're dealing with a ballpark or even Six Flags, you have no clue who those people are. You don't know what their background are, where they came from. And so trying to identify someone that's out of place, it's almost impossible. That's when you have to start worrying about the indicators and what you're looking for that is strange. But again, in my world, when you're dealing with 41,000 people, strange is relative. I mean, you're trying to figure out, especially if we're playing the Sox, it's really hard to figure out what strange is. They all look strange to me. So it makes the job difficult when you're dealing with a soft target and you've got a population of people inside your property that you have no clue who they are. Security must be provided for the facility. So this one right here is a challenge. Is again, dealing with malls in my years with the hotel world, is the funding and making sure that you're already a soft target. Some of the things I talk about preventing and being able to deter violence or terrorism or to your property or location as a soft target is, it's going to involve funding. Sometimes it involves manpower, and that's a challenge that a lot of us face, especially after 2008. I wrote this originally, this program, I think in 2009, 2010. It was right after 2008 where a lot of budgets started getting cut. And one of the challenges I found is trying to prevent that bad thing from happening at your soft target was going to take money, and I was going in the other direction at that time. So some venues have high turnover, which makes it hard for that consistency and that training. Sports venues and I could say probably some hotels might have this problem, but even like Six Flags and some of the entertainment venues, they deal with a lot of seasonal help. We have a core group of people, but we have over 1,000 seasonal employees, because we're not playing baseball in the winter, so we don't hire them year-round. So we get a new group every year. With that new group every year, we're losing that consistency of right from the get-go. Now we're having to retrain people. We're having to get them used to our building. And, you know, it's a challenge you face when you're trying to get that consistency and maintain that security, and you're constantly having turnover. So some threat examples that I think are really important to note when you're dealing with soft targets is obviously the IED. The vehicle-borne IED is one that you see with Oklahoma City, and some of the examples I'm going to give here. It's one that I worry about when I talk about that Addison being 6 feet from my venue. Small arms, active shooter. Obviously, this is one that I think scares a lot of us today. It only takes that lone wolf to walk into a movie theater or a church, not yet, but a ballpark, and with one gun and, you know, one clip of 15 rounds doing a lot of damage, mostly from the reaction and the fear it promotes. An armed siege or assault. So some examples, in July 17th in 2009, this is an example of a person who used the IED, came into this Ritz-Carlton Marriott and killed 7 people, wounded 50. You know, again, it's a small explosive device, very little screening that this person had to get through to get in here and cause a lot of damage. And again, all these things and all these threats soft targets face, it's all about promoting the fear, interrupting commerce, preventing people from doing their normal day activities. October 7th in Egypt, here's a Hilton hotel and a truck bomb. You know, again, you talk about like what the damage one rider truck full of ammonium nitrate can do to the Oklahoma City. Again, this, if you don't have that set off point, if you don't have a way to be able to keep the vehicles from your building, a lot of damage could be caused. 30 people were killed in this, 150 others wounded. This one, I think, is the one that I worry about and I lose sleep at night is, you know, if we all remember Virginia Tech, April 6, 2007. This is one person. One person with a gun caused all this damage, killed 32 people in a place that's supposed to be, you know, for higher learning. You don't go to school and think that something bad's going to happen to you that day. And this is the one, especially with ISIS and a lot of Inspire magazine trying to keep people, trying to promote the lone wolf. Don't call us, don't reach out to us, don't try to come and do training with us in our terrorist camps, just go buy a gun and go do some harm. That will help our cause. So it's those things that really I lose sleep overnight, you know, what if someone got a gun into my facility in the middle of a game with 41,000 and just pulled off 2 shots? It's not the shots that are going to hurt people. It's going to be the trampling of fans trying to get out of the way of all that. Armed siege, October 23rd, 2002, in Moscow. This is a movie theater. Over 130 hostages died. And I pointed this one out because obviously the hostages and the siege is how this thing started to unravel, but it was actually the first response and the gas that was put in there that killed a lot of the people that were inside this movie theater, or this theater. One of the things that I'll note when we talk about some things you can do is I think it's important to document with when the federal government or the first responders take over the scene. When they come in and they say, we're in charge now, I think it's important to document that because when something goes south down the road, you can sit back and look and say, at this time, this is when the federal government came in. At this time, they told us they were in charge of the scene. I mean, you help and you're in a supportive role at that time, but when things go south, you want to be able to document that. So protective measures. I think that, and this goes back to the money piece of it, mobile security, visible security, and being able to deter that bad thing from happening. And a lot of the experts will tell you that the professional terrorism that is coming to do bad to your property, they're gonna have drive runs. They're gonna surveil you. They're gonna watch to see what you're doing. You know, they come around every hour on the dot. They patrol left to right. They're going to be looking at those things to determine if your target, your soft target, is something that they want to target personally. You know, unfortunately, I tell my boss all the time that we need to harden our target. We need to do things like deterring, making sure that we're clearly visible, that we're not trying to put our security people in a suit and hide them in the corner so no one sees them. You want them to be visible. You want them to be able to deter the bad guy to go somewhere else. Because to me, hardening the target is I wish no ill will to any other property, but I don't want the bad thing to happen at my property. So to harden my target, if that means I got to put my guys in very visible security uniforms, have them patrolling in different areas and not repeating the same tour route, making sure that even when we do our training, it's somewhat visible that we're prepared and we're ready to deal with things because I'm trying to prevent the bad thing happening at my location. Layer security programs and drills, again, you know, what layers do you have? If I talk about a hotel, for example, is yes, you can walk right into the lobby, but there's another layer of security to get to the back of the house. And this can be a challenge with your management team and your other departments is you want to do some kind of access control from the front of the house to the back of the house, and then you have your housekeepers or your maintenance people. It's like, well, it's a pain in the butt for me to constantly push this code in to go back here. Yes, but I'm trying to protect you to make sure you can go home well at night. So sometimes it's a challenge when you create these layers to get the actual staff to buy in. But it's important to fight that battle to make sure that, yes, I can keep the bad guy, I can keep the bad guy from coming into the back of the house and really doing damage in my boiler room or in my infrastructure. So having those layers are important. I talked about this, creating a standoff. It's kind of hard sometimes. Some buildings have done it well. Some of our O's over, listen to me, I sound like a still work with Hilton. Some of Hilton's overseas properties, they actually have a checkpoint before you ever get within 100 to 200 feet of the hotel. Some of the hotels overseas actually deploy their own canine units and do screening, again, at a standoff point. So if these things are, if we're even looking at it at the ballpark, we're trying to get the city during games or during concerts to be able to close down Addison. If we could close down Addison and Clark, we already closed down Sheffield and Waveland, we'd be in a better place. But again, it's what you can do, how you can manage that, not only if you own the facility and you could take a few rows of parking spaces and push that perimeter out, anything you can do to make sure that vehicle-borne IED stays away from your property. Why do I have that in there? Secure the back of the house. We kind of talked about this. Try to restrict movements. I've worked in some hotels in the past in DC. We all had credentials. Every employee had a credential. It had to be visible. I've worked in other hotels that don't do that. Then how do you know who belongs and who doesn't belong? Some of the most simple things to deploy are just hard because management doesn't want to do it or your leadership doesn't want to do it. But credentials is a big way to be able to protect the back of your house. And again, can you secure it? Can you use access control? Mass notification. If you have an active shooter situation, how do you get the word out? How do you make sure that people are in other parts of your facility can get out before the guy with the gun gets too far into your facility? You know, sometimes it's not preventing the incident, it's mitigating it from being worse. So what things do you have there to mitigate it? We talked about this, strong identification programs, contractors. So we talked about the employees, but what are you doing for visitor management? How are you making sure, I give you an example at the ballpark, in the past if we weren't having a game, contractors just came in and they walked around the ballpark and they worked on things. I'd walk through the ballpark and I'd see some strange guy with a toolkit walking around. I had no idea, had he been checked, had he been verified, do we know who he is? So we had to make some changes to make that happen. And I talk about my own experiences. You might not have had these same experiences, but you walk into a place like Wrigley Field and you've got people in your electrical department that has been there for 30 years, getting them to change their mindset can be difficult, but it's worth the fight. It's worth to make sure to explain to them, I want you to go home safe at night. I understand you've been doing, we've all heard this before. It's the way we've always done it. We've always done it this way. That's great. Just because you've always done it that way doesn't make it right. So how can we fix this to make sure that we can all go home at night? Strict dock and parking management. What are you doing? What is your dock procedures to account for the car before it pulls up to the dock or the loading dock? Are you checking them at I use the United Center, for example. All the vehicles before they approach the loading dock is almost 200 to 300 feet away with a deployable Ballard system before they ever get to the loading dock. Parking lots. Are you patrolling the parking lots? Is there a sticker system? Who should be in the parking lot? Do visitors get a tag? How do you know what cars are in your parking lot? So training. I think training is a big one, especially not only with the employers or any partners. For example, Levy Concessions, they have about 500 employees that work inside of our ballpark. Who all are you including in your training? The more people you include in the training, the better the response. If you have an active shooter response training, just don't train the security people. Involve the employees. Get the employees involved. Do you do an orientation? I think an orientation is big with all employees. I had a saying that I did with every time I did an orientation for our employees, I would say, who do you think my first line of security defense is? Oh, management, security, the guys in uniform. I was like, no, each one of you. I depend on you telling me when you see the guy talking to himself and his briefcase is ticking. I hope you tell me about that guy. It's all about to see something, say something. You've got employees. When you're dealing with the Palmer House is 1,800,000 square foot hotel. You have on any given day, you know, 7 or 8 security professionals walking around that building. They cannot be everywhere at once, even with all the cameras. You need a housekeeper that walked into that hotel room that saw tons of boxes, that it smelled high in ammonia in there. That room just seemed weird. You need that person to come to you and feel comfortable to tell you that. I always, after I told him about telling me about the guy talking to himself, my next thing was, I'd rather you tell me 100 times about something that turns out to be nothing than not tell me about the one time it was the real deal. I don't care how many times it turns out to be nothing. Always tell me if something looks strange to you. If your gut feels funny, tell me about it. And those conversations shouldn't only be with your security professionals or your managers. Every line employee in your facility helps you protect your facility. I'm moving quick. I'm sorry, guys. We'll talk a little bit more after this. So the future of soft targets. Overseas, there's already car inspections in a lot of areas before you approach the perimeter. Checkpoints are in place. I spent a lot of time in Panama when I was in the service, and even back then, if you walked into a grocery store, there was a guy there with an automatic weapon in the grocery store. So I believe we're not there yet, but I don't believe this thing is going to, I don't believe soft targets or active shooter or the lone wolf syndrome is going away anytime soon. And I just think it's a matter of time before you see different security procedures. I mean, who thought before 9/11 going to the airport would be as drastically security different than today than it was before then? I mean, my little airport in Roanoke, Virginia, I mean, you could walk right up to the boarding area and greet people when they got off. Now you have security checkpoints. Things have changed, and I truly believe that things are going to get there again. So I'll talk a little bit more about the experiences I have and the things I deal with, and I'm going to open it to questions. But one of the reasons that I initially chose that slide, again, is soft target starts with your design. And even though your building's already built, you're going to do capital projects. Your engineering department is going to build a plaza. There's opportunity in every part of the design of your building moving forward and the renovations of your building to help protect it from being a soft target. It doesn't have to be hardcore ballers, but it can be planners. You can change the way that your entrance is. There's a lot of things you can do in the design portion to protect your property, and I'm going through those things right now. Go ahead.
Question, you talked about the standoff setback and so on at the Cups Field, and most of us in private security, one of our big concerns is liability. And have you or the Cubs actually sent a letter to the city of Chicago saying, hey, we would like this closed off during days of football games, so that you're on record officially as you know in Chicago, they're going to come back and say, hey, you never asked us.
Yeah.
And I guess that applies to all of us. Do we go on record officially?
Yeah, I think you should, and we do. One of the things, you know, Worthgren and Hilton all those years, the lawyers were at the corporate office. I started working for the Cubs, and we had 3 lawyers in the office. Most of that's for signing contracts for baseball players. But it has come to one of our lawyers, Lydia. She will go on record. She'll write to them requesting that you shut these things off, especially now we're getting in our postseason planning. And you know, Major League Baseball asks for one thing. We, in turn, take that ask to the city, and we put it in writing to protect ourselves liable from the liability aspect of that. But I think you should go on record.
Sir, what collaborative efforts have you run across in your experience to get the different departments within your organization to communicate so that maid does come up and say, I think I smell something? for the guy that works perhaps in the stationary engineer supplies information that he otherwise wouldn't work. And in essence, what have you done to encourage that collaborative effort?
I think it starts at the top. I was pretty successful with some pretty good GMs at the properties I worked at. Getting the GM or the big guy, whatever organization you work at, to at an all association meeting to talk about it, to promote it, and then carrying that down to the orientation. When I first started with the Cubs, orientation consisted of HR sitting down to you and talking about benefits and moving on. They didn't talk about workers' comp or safety programs or security, see something, say something. So I really encourage everyone in getting in, one, getting it the buy-in from the top and having the voice come from the top. And the second piece of that is getting with your HR and saying, hey, give me 45 minutes. I need 45 minutes to speak to every employee on safety and security. If they don't give you 45 minutes and they give you 15, then focus on the see something, say something. And when you have all associate meetings, get an opportunity once, if you do them quarterly, try to get one quarter a year to get up and talk to the group. Again, I lighten the mood by saying, if you see the guy with the briefcase and it's smoking and he's talking to himself, I try to lighten it so they remember it. But you got to get their buy-in to tell you something. I remember during the anthrax scare, I had a housekeeper run to me because it was baby powder. It was sparkly baby powder that was all over the place in the room, and she thought it might be anthrax. But I told her, when she said, I'm sorry, Larry, I said, don't be sorry. I'd rather you call me. I'd rather go up there and find out that it's baby powder and go through the steps than to treat everything like, oh, I'm sure it's nothing. You can't. So back to your point, when you get the collaboration, you can't sit there and blow them off either. You got to let them know it's important, and you got to thank them. We had a bomb threat a couple days ago. The first thing I did was pull the operator in with all the other operators, thanked him for the information he gave us, and told the other operators what he did right. Because the information that he gave me allowed me to make an informed decision on whether I thought the threat was credible or not. So I took that moment and shared it with the rest of the operators so they were able to understand what we did and why we did it. Back there, oh, go ahead, you can go first. I'll get him next.
So I've got a question. In reference to my liaison activity that you have to bring in to support all the activity that goes on there, what are some best practices you use to work with the local police?
A big one is open up your facility. I really am a firm believer in inviting the FBI, SWAT, or your local response teams to come in the facility after hours or when it's closed or non-baseball season and conduct drills. Example being the local field office for the FBI is going to come to our ballpark. They're going to do some scenarios with their snipers and their counter-assault teams, and they're going to train in my facility. It does two things. One, it builds the relationship. The other thing it does is have them become familiar with my facility. So if something bad happens and they have to respond, they've trained in it. They know where the exits are. They know where the high points are for views of the scene. So I think it goes a long way of opening your facility and getting them in there. If you have the means with the local cops to feed them, I could tell you at the Palmer House, I fed every local cop in the world in our cafeteria, and that sounds little, but the day we had a big protest against a group, I literally went up to the cafeteria and said, hey, I need some bodies out here, and they were there like that. It sounds silly, but it's a big relationship builder that has worked for me in the past.
So I appreciate the timing of the presentation, and it's ironic that I just pulled up the Cubs in playoffs.
Yes.
Honestly, 9 minutes ago, this article just posted in the Times, and it said, is Wrigley Field ready for possible home playoff game? And it talks about exactly what you're talking about. The end of the article was, there's a little bit of extra everything you're talking about here this morning. Being a baseball fan, you go to games and you see, if you see something, send a text to whatever number, right?
Yeah.
I've never fortunately had to, but I've always wondered, what are the receiving end of those messages? You guys get 500 a game, you get 10 a game. I mean, what is the social embrace of you all reaching out to your fans, helping, you know, magnify that message?
So we put it on the back of the ticket, the texting program. ISS is the group we use. It's kind of interesting because it's a reporting software too, so the text can be elevated to an incident and we can track them. It's actually, I would say about 75% of our techs are great techs. Some of them are, the person in front of me is becoming unruly and is verily intoxicated. We've had some say, hey, I need a beer. I haven't seen the beer guy in a while. So we get all kinds of texts. Hey, can you tell the coach to get the pitcher out of there? He sucks. I mean, excuse my language, but I mean, you get the one-offs. The nice thing about the texting, I don't know what kind of other venues we have here. I actually use that texting software. So back to your point, we communicate it on the ticket. We will have outside communications, like speakers to communicate when you're coming in the ballpark. Please have your pockets empty, have your bag. So that's coming online with the renovation next year. But we also put it on our new jumbo screen every half inning, the texting. It works great. You get some false ones or funny ones that you, it has prompts that you can say, please, this is an official text. If you continue, we're going to block your text number. So it has some features to go back to the knuckleheads that are doing the false text. But I've taken that text program and moved it internally for my employees. Back to the see something, say something, that every one of our employees know that they can text us that, hey, there's some weird guy standing over here talking about he's going to bring a goat head to the ballpark and let it on fire. I mean, so we use it internally as well. If y'all don't know, there's some kind of goat curse and people like to bring goat heads to the ballpark. So does that answer your question?
I've never heard anything of the responses back from the use of the technology to have the fans, you know, reporting what's going on.
The texting program is great. A lot of venues are using it right now. And like I said, it's tied to an incident reporting software, so you can elevate them or you can push. You can reverse text on that as well. So we've used that during our convention to communicate back to the everyone that's registered. So you can register your text number at our convention, and we can push texts out saying Joe Madden's going to sign in the ballroom B in an hour. So you can reverse text on that program as well. Yes? The texting piece, you know, I don't know if other venues are other than ballpark stadiums, football stadiums, and things like that are big in the ISS. I know the United Center for the Hawks and the Bulls use it. I don't see it have been pushed out as much into other areas. I think it has a value. You could almost roll it out to your guests if you see something weird. I could see at the Hawaiian Village having that at check-in. And if a guest sees some weird guy scouting people at the pool, text it, and it could go back to the dispatch and they could respond. Everyone has a phone nowadays. I see a use that it could be.
Just as a point of reference, I work at a small college in Massachusetts. We use that.
Yeah.
The first year student, all the students come in, they register their text number, if something's going on campus.
I mean, with smartphones today, there's so much that you can do, and I think a lot of what we do today is communications. The more information you have, the better you can respond to things. Getting people involved is a big one. Text is easy. Yes, sir. It's based off of planning mostly. So the ratio, so you have your hardcore, security guys, which is mostly all of my staff, full-time and part-time year-round staff. Then interior, you have your security ambassadors, which is more of dealing with fights and drunks and unruly guests. And then you have your ushers, which they perform a security function as well, making sure people aren't in the wrong section and things of that nature. So Where the challenge is, are we playing the White Sox? Yeah, we're definitely, because those Southsiders, you know, they got a lot of anger issues. But we will ramp up for the Sox series or for the St. Louis series. Concerts, well, there's a lot more alcohol drinking going on with concerts, so we'll ramp up for that. So that ratio is mostly based off of what the data that we have from previous years. That's where I think the report writing software comes in handy, is being able to know what you're doing as far as a incident based off of event, and then doing your ratios off of that. You made her ask the question?
No, you were ignoring her.
Okay. So let me see if I can understand the question. So like as far as them giving us information that they've seen something strange in a room?
Yeah, so say for example in the situation that you have where the maid reported, you know, the suspected anthrax, just keeping the guests at ease that, you know, we need to check this out or we think it might be a security concern. How do you approach that?
You know, most of the time, like that was a room that was already checked out. So in that particular scenario, the guest was already gone. But I would say, you know, a lot of times, depending on the information we got, we have to determine whether or not there's initial degree of harm to our other guests. For example, if a housekeeper came to me, and I can say this because I don't work in the hotel industry anymore, and Hilton can't get me in trouble anymore. If a housekeeper came to me and said, I saw a shotgun in the corner of a room that I just cleaned. To me, there's an initial bodily harm to the surrounding guest. So I'm immediately going to respond to that room. I'm probably going to respond to that room with some kind of local law enforcement help. And a lot of times, again, you handle it with the hospitality. I said, sorry, sir, ma'am, we have to enter a room. We've got a report of a potential issue in this room. And you enter it that way. And you document your steps while you're doing it. So yes, say you go in the room and there's no one in that room and there's guns and stuff everywhere. Again, you need to make sure that you're first determining if there's harm to the people around, your employees or your guests. And then the second piece is getting local law enforcement involved if that threat is at that level. And the last piece is making sure you document everything well so that back to the liability side that you're protecting yourself. Yes, sir. Oh, a lot of them. So MLB, it's interesting, is back to being America's sport. MLB is one of the first ones to, or the last ones to implement mag screening. This year is the first year that it's actually mandatory to do mag screening at ballparks. So that was one of the mandates, which is easy for some of the newer ballparks. It's a little more difficult for us older ballparks. The other mandates, there was a lot of them they put in there, you know, the 100-foot standoff, your screening practices at your gates, vehicles, how do you check perimeter, how do you check vehicles that are inside that 100-foot perimeter, what steps you're taking place. They're going for Safety Act approval, MLB, so they're putting all these stringent guidelines in to try to get MLB Safety Act certified. So there's a lot of them. Yeah, it's interesting. When they first hired me, I found out MLB was going for Safety Act approval. I thought maybe part of the reason that they recruited me was because of that. There's not that many. We had this conversation earlier. I think there's a difference in the need for a security professional with a CPP at different ballparks depending on the ballpark. We are one of three ballparks, our ball clubs, out of the 30 that actually own our facility. Example being the White Sox, it's a state park. So the state owns the cell. Soldier Field is a city park. It's owned by the city park system. Wrigley is owned by the Ricketts family. So the fact that we own that, and I think everyone that works in there, and we own our Mesa facility, our training facilities, changed the fact that they hired someone that had more of a physical security and a security background versus someone that had event background and being able to deal with fans. So I think that portion had a little bit of it. As far as the CPP, I could tell you our lawyers was they were very satisfied that we had it and the protection that the CPP carries under the National Safety Act. So our lawyers were, I do think they were looking at that when they made their hiring decision. Any other questions? Yes.
You spoke about the issues they have with yes or and, if you will, but obviously inside you're going to have your own group of employees or contract employees. Do you have any issues as far as vetting them with background checks or anything like that? How you handle that when they're not really your employees or contractors?
Yeah. The what?
Yeah, beer tech.
We get the beer techs a lot. You really needed a beer. And back to your question, MLB is now required that all of our staff, as well as our contract staff, have fully vetted background checks, which surprisingly was not a mandate before. But to your point, you need to know who's in your building. If you've got someone with like a Levy group that's working all 81 games of your baseball season or whatever your venue or building is, you should know who's in it and you should know that they've had you should be able to sleep good at night that you've had a background check. But even with that said, you know, the see something, say something with your employees should go along with or with their coworkers as well. If a coworker is acting odd and just talk about the workplace violence. I mean, you need to know who's in how people are reacting in your building. If you know someone said, you know what, I'm gonna light this place up one day. I mean, yeah, people say something in the heat of the moment, but it's worthy of telling someone and having HR be able to help get that guy counseling before it gets to that level. Because, you know, the active shooter doesn't have to be a lone wolf syndrome or situation. It can be a workplace violence. And that's even worse because they know your facility. They know your hours of operations. They know how to get in and cause some damage. I meant, I'm from Roanoke, Virginia, and that situation that was with the two TV reporters, I've taken my children to where that happened. We fed the fish at that pier where that shooting happened. And that was workplace violence. The guy was not happy. He felt like the reporter took his job. And what's worse is with technology today, he videotaped it with a GoPro and put it up on the internet within minutes. I mean, and what's worse is the media gave him what he wanted, his moment of fame. I mean, they were running stuff on CNN. They had a special the next night on NBC. So it's a technology in the media today has, I think, made our jobs tougher. That's a side note. Yes, sir.
What kind of training do you apply before you your security personnel? Is it mostly internal, or do you bring in law enforcement agencies, public being, active shooting mitigation, or surveillance, action? Like, what kind of training do you apply?
Yeah, to further answer the gentleman's question up here front, MLB has required that as well. We're required to have all new hire employees are required to have 30 hours of anti-terrorism training. We use a combination of some of the online training that FEMA and DHS provides, but we also we partner with our local law enforcement. We do active shooter through the FBI. We do the explosive and suspicious package training through our local police department. We bring the K-9 units in and the EOD guys. And then we also partner with CHEA, our mag detectors, to talk about screening process, when you get hits, how do you do secondary screening. So we partner both with the public sector, the private sector, and our vendors to get that training together. Major League Baseball doesn't dictate how we do it, but I think it's important to involve everyone that you have access to have good, solid training. Anyone else? I appreciate everybody. Thank you. I'll be up here if anybody else has any other questions.